This is Theodos 6, still going by the Digital Research brand. And this is Theodos 6 with the new branding following Novell's acquisition. And here I've got Novell.7, which after all is just a renamed Theodos 7 and in the end the only true heir to Gary Kildall's CPM legacy.
This is September, the month you wanna CPM, the ancestor to DOS. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories. It's been exactly 50 years since Gary Kildall created CPM in 1974. Largely disappeared from the collective memory, CPM soon became the de facto operating system standard for microcomputers. Be it the Altair 8800, of which I do have this Arduino-based replica, or the world's first commercially successful portable, the Osborne 1, the many K-Pro machines, the MSI 8080 and its near-identical sibling, the Chromemco Z1, or even the TRS-80, they all ran CPM. Also the Apple II with the Z80 soft card, Commodore with the C128, and by means of a special Z80 cartridge even the C64 could run CPM. And the list would go on and on. CPM was everywhere during the 70s long before the reign of MS-DOS until it disappeared. So what happened? Let's start at the early beginnings, when Gary Kildall at the age of 30 worked as a consultant for Intel and developed PLM, the programming language for microcomputers. He soon after conceived CPM, originally named Control Program Monitor, though through the course of commercializing the product in 1977 rebranded to Control Program for Microcomputers. CPM was originally developed for the Intel Intellect development platform, early microcomputers even predating the now iconic Altair 8800 by several years. CPM was based around three components, the basic input-output system, aka BIOS, the basic disk operating system, aka BDOS, and the console command processor, CCP. All the hardware specifics were encapsulated into the BIOS part, which meant that adapting CPM for other hardware platforms was easily achievable. This concept, which is now known as a hardware abstraction layer, was a novelty back then, as in the early days of computing, operating systems were specifically tied to a given platform and not foreseen to be portable to another. This helped Kildall's then freshly founded company, Intergalactic Digital Research, which later shortened the company name to just Digital Research, from the ground up. CPM was soon licensed to many different vendors. It is said that by 1981, Digital Research had sold somewhat of 260,000 CPM licenses. According to some sources, even more, but there's no real proven figures. From today's perspective, these numbers may sound very small. But one has to consider that during the 70s era, microcomputers had not yet become a mass phenomenon like today, where we have billions of PCs, tablets, smartphones and whatnot out there. Let's put it into perspective at the example of the iconic Altair 8800, which sold somewhat 25,000 units, or the MSI 8080, which produced somewhere between 17 to 20,000 units. And the latter is also a good example, as it didn't actually run vanilla CPM, but a modified version called IMDOS, for which DRI sold a fixed fee non-exclusive use license to IMS Associates for $25,000. Having said that, it's unclear whether the aforementioned 260,000 CPM licenses also account for any such sublicenses or not. For certain is, however, the microcomputer market was mostly dominated by CPM at that stage. But things started to turn by the early 80s, when IBM began development on the original IBM PC, where they chose the Intel 8088 for their platform. The 8086 and the 8088 came out in 1978 and 1979 respectively, and when IBM was incorporating the 8088 into their design, they were looking for an operating system. Now, the quick story goes like this. Microsoft, whom had been contracted by IBM to deliver the ROM BASIC, didn't have an operating system. Well, technically they did, with Xenix, a Unix derivative, but that was too hardweight for the IBM PC. So Bill Gates suggested IBM to have a word with Gary Kildall. Now, it had been told manifold times what ultimately did or did not happen during the events when the IBM representatives wanted to meet up with Kildall, whether he was flying in his plane or whatever. But to cut it short, IBM didn't come to an agreement with DRI in the first place and turned back to Microsoft. And Microsoft turned to Seattle Computing Products and a young programmer called Tim Patterson, whom the year prior had written his quick and dirty operating system, QDOS, which was later renamed to 86DOS. The reason Patterson wrote 86DOS was simply because DRI had failed to deliver an 8086 compatible version of CPM as they had originally announced for 1979. So he was filling the gap and DRI being too late to the game as it seems. Because at that point, when DRI began renegotiating with IBM to offer CPM as their PC operating system, the latter had already struck a deal with Microsoft. Microsoft first licensed and then ultimately bought 86DOS from Seattle Computing Products to make it IBM DOS and MS-DOS. And when DRI finally could deliver CPM 86 in 1982, it sold for a horrendous $240. Now compare that to the $40 that IBM charged for IBM DOS.
Gary, are we at the end of the line in the evolution of computer hardware, or are there major new phases of this evolutionary process still to come?
Well, fortunately, we're obviously not at the end of the line. We're at some point in time in the evolution of using microprocessors as general-purpose computers.
At this point, Kildall probably didn't actively involve any more into the CPM development, as by the late 70s, DRI grew and new names came in for working on CPM, notably Catherine Stratinsky, Bob Silverstein and Dave K. Brown. So CPM development continued along. However, the events around the IBM PC and being too late with CPM 86 can certainly be seen as a missed opportunity here. One might argue if one of the other inherent flaws around the incompatible disk formats were a hindering point or not in the long run. I had explored this topic in another video a while ago, stating that there were several hundred incompatible disk formats in the CPM world. While the good thing of CPM was the BIOS as its hardware abstraction layer, it allowed any vendor to use whatever floppy disk drives they wanted. It actually even went that far that the vendors had to implement their own file system. But this then led to a plethora of incompatible disk formats. And software vendors had to take that into account, as they often had to provide the software on the maybe 20 most significant disk formats to have the broadest reach. Now, as I wasn't there at that point, I can't really tell. But I could imagine that bringing CPM 86 onto the PC platform and it again not being able to read the vast amounts of CPM 80 disk formats was maybe not ideal. Worse to say that neither DOS nor CPM 86 could read each other's disk formats natively. Of course, in the early days of the PCs, there was still some rumble, as when the first PC clones arrived, there were the ones like Compaq, whom went one-to-one for close to 100% compatibility, and others whom just did not. And actually, I had looked at one example of the HP Portable and the Portable Plus, which actually used, as well, a not fully compatible disk format, which hindered data exchange between DOS-based systems. But that period of early incompatible systems didn't last long, and it soon became clear to most, if not all, vendors that the common denominator to sell their products was the IBM PC compatibility. Meanwhile, DRI was busy catching up. Of course, as someone coming 40 years later, it's easy to criticize, and this may set off some people. Please don't get me wrong, I'm really just phrasing out my observance and impression here. When looking at the development history of CPM during the 80s period, to me it feels just like, and I'm really sorry to say, chaotic and somewhat without a clear plan or marketing strategy. Especially during the 80s period, it reads like CPM 80, CPM 86, concurrent CPM 86 and MPM 86, DR concurrent PC DOS, DR concurrent DOS, concurrent DOS XM DOS Plus, DR DOS, concurrent DOS, DR multi-user DOS and whatnot. Someone then actually put together a fairly complete timeline, tracing the BDOS versions and lining them up chronologically with the different products. When looking at this more closely, it is still somewhat clear in the later stages of CPM development when you had the original single-user and single-tasking version of CPM, the single-user but multitasking version called concurrent CPM, and the multi-user multitasking version called MPM. Ultimately, these all came to an end, with only the concurrent line surviving, eventually splitting out again into a single-user and a multi-user branch. That alone is not so much a problem, but look at the many name changes during that period. When I'm already puzzled bringing those pieces back together in retrospect, then I wonder how consumers would have felt back in the day with the products changing their names all the time. And then again, did they make any sense? Let's take DR Concurrent DOS 386, which was intended to run on a 386 or better CPU. Now, the previous DR Concurrent DOS ran only on 286s and earlier, and it is said, to avoid confusion with Concurrent DOS 386, it was renamed to DR Concurrent DOS XM to say, that's the 286 and earlier version. Well, then call it like that. DR concurrent DOS 286. Okay, it's more complicated than that, as admittedly DOS XM also ran on the 8086. Though my perception, what we see here is likely symptomatic for a period where digital research had to not only deal with the decline and obsolescence of CPM, while at the same time dealing with the fact that MS-DOS was outplacing them from the market. To me, it seemed like to take somewhat 4 to 5 years for DRI to find themselves and come down to at least two streams being DR-DOS and DR multi-user DOS. Next time on The Vintage Collector. After the demise of CPM and the troubled first half of the 80s with hundreds of employees laid off, Gary Kildall stepping down as a CEO and DRI seeking even the help of investors to survive, it seemed the company could ultimately make the turn with the advent of DR-DOS. But then another player crashed the party. Novell acquired DRI. For the better or the worse.